Hello, everyone. Welcome to History Spaces, hopefully again. And I'm here with Jeff Messerman. Hi, Jeff.
Good morning. That was not me on the clarinet.
Oh, that was Benny Goodman and All the Cats Join In, which I think we will be adopting as our new theme song, possibly.
As a cat owner, I appreciate that.
Yeah, well, yes. we're hep cats here at History Spaces. Yes,
we are now.
Oh, gosh.
Now I've never been accused of that before.
Well, I accuse you. Everyone out there, Jeff is a hep cat. Come on in and see him. Say hi. Come on into the library. Ask for Mr. Messerman.
It's a lonely life.
Look for the most impressive-looking guy in the library.
Oh, you're too kind.
That will be Jeff.
I'm in dire need of a haircut right now. I look like John Paul George and Ringo.
Oh.
It's terrible.
I think that's pretty cool. Hey, you know, this is the first of a two-parter, and I entitled it The Andrew and Rachel Jackson Love Story.
Oh, well, that's
one and two.
That's going to be a two-parter, no matter how you slice it.
Oh, yeah, there's just too much to talk about. I mean, books have been written about this stuff. But, you know, we know so much about other presidents' wives, you know, Jackie Kennedy, Mary Todd Lincoln, Martha Washington, and Sarah Polk, and others. But
and yet we barely know anything about our current first lady. We don't know much about her.
She has a low profile.
She's a mystery woman.
Yes, I wonder why. There's a story. But anyway, but the one that fascinates me most of all is the story between Andrew and Rachel. And again, their love story. Now, we're going to be looking at some very sentimental and romantic things having to do with their life together. However, when I was doing the research for this, I came across an interesting fact all the way up until today. Because of Andrew Jackson's implementation of the Trail of Tears and kicking the Native American tribes out of Georgia and other places and taking them across the Mississippi and transplanting them to Oklahoma in very unsavory circumstances and causing a lot of death and destruction culturally and physically. To this very day, there are members of the Cherokee Nation in Oklahoma who will not touch a $20 bill. They will not carry it. They will not touch it. They will not deal with it because his picture is on that bill. So there's another argument for possibly having Harriet Tubman replace him on the $20 bill there. So I just thought I'd mention that. That was really interesting.
Might help the economy. More 20s floating around the, Oklahoma. So, you know.
Oh, gee.
You know, I mean, yeah. I've got to look at it from all angles. You know, there's easy ways around that. Of course, you could just carry a bunch of, you know, just make sure you have that bill broken before you hand it over. I'll take that in fives. Can I have all singles, please? You know,
a lot of tens and fives and
right.
Everything.
Absolutely.
In Oklahoma. So, anyway, let's get down to Andrew and Rachel. Now, you know, Andrew Jackson was actually the first president to be born in a log cabin. Really, he was born in a log cabin. And I think North and South Carolina kind of argue about just which state is fairly close to the line or whatever.
It's
I guess
so
it
petty.
Moved around.
So petty.
Yeah. Well. And he spent much of his life in love with and deeply devoted to his wife, Rachel Donaldson Jackson. And she suffered greatly at the hands of her husband's political enemies during the course of his career. As they tried to use, these enemies tried to use the unusual and scandalous circumstances surrounding the beginnings of their relationship in an attempt to destroy her husband's political career.
You know, I think we should just say the wives are off limits, you know. Can we do that for politics? Can we just leave the wives out? They do that with the children pretty well. But
well, we're going to dispel the myth that, you know, things were actually better in the past. No, they weren't. If anything, they were just as bad, if not worse.
Oh, my.
Yeah, people had no discretion as far as what was fair game in the political arena. Now, theirs, Andrew and Rachel, was one of the great love stories of our nation's early history. They had met in 1790 when he had arrived in Nashville, Tennessee, to take up his duties as the new public prosecutor for the western part of the state. This was early in his career, soon after he had gotten his law degree. not from a university, but he was just being tutored and mentored in an office. So she was 21 and he was 22 years old.
So he's like a mail order lawyer? Is that
The training was not what it is today. It wasn't like 7 years, 4 years undergrad, and then 3 or 4 years law school. No,
I wonder if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I'm not sure. You know.
Well, education has become an industry.
It has indeed. You know?
So,
yeah.
Anyway, Rachel was separated from her husband, Louis Robards of Kentucky, and living with her mother at the boarding house that she ran in Nashville, Tennessee. Now, one of the boarders there was, here we go, Andrew Jackson. He was also there. And he took an immediate but very respectful interest in young Rachel.
That sounds like a great Avon paperback, Our Boarding House Romance.
Well, a Hallmark Channel.
Sure.
I think Hallmark Channel is calling here. Now, by all accounts, she was a beautiful and very alluring young woman who was a great dancer, had a very winning smile, and smoked a corncob pipe.
That's
kind of interesting.
Pretty foxy, yeah.
Yeah, so a lifelong pipe smoker.
Yeah.
They spent more and more time together until her husband appeared in order to attempt to salvage their 4-year marriage. So she must have gotten married quite young, 17, 18 years old at the latest. Now, this Louis Robards, he saw the attraction between Jackson and his wife. And being a man of quick emotions and a violent temper, and I always think, you know, it's kind of like Jackson himself. That's why those two guys didn't like each other, because they were exact mirror images of each other.
That's my favorite term of the week now, by the way. A man of quick emotions. I like that. I'm a big fan of that. That's great.
I know you keep that under control here. Right?
I do.
Now, Robards angrily confronted Jackson on a number of occasions, accusing him of trying to steal away his wife. Jackson just as angrily denounced Robards as a scoundrel. That's a lovely 19th century
word.
It's
a great word,
it?
Too.
A scoundrel.
You're really bringing the goods today.
For doubting the innocence and honor of Rachel. They almost came to blows during these heated arguments. And in one instance, Robards threatened to kill Jackson during one of these heated verbal exchanges.
Which you can't do as much nowadays.
Can't threaten to kill?
Just,
no.
You just randomly threaten to kill someone.
Well,
throwaway line.
You get a restraining order from court, and we really know just how effective those things are in preventing violence, especially domestic violence. And don't get me started on this. Okay. Now, Jackson suggested a duel, but Robards only answered him with more insults and profanity. Didn't want to accept that. Now, the air was temporarily cleared when Jackson left on his circuit rounds of western Tennessee and had to follow the court around. And Rachel returned with her husband to Kentucky to attempt a reconciliation. She returned to Nashville weeks later, however, after continued arguments and abuse from her husband again drove her away. Now, Robards followed her back to Nashville. Now, why did he come? Wasn't he tried again? Didn't work, and he came back.
I'm assuming he didn't come to see the Grand Ole Opry.
Just didn't want to let go. You know?
Right.
She returned to Nashville, of course. Robards followed, and he accused Jackson again of being too intimate with his wife. Now, Jackson threatened, I love this, it gets wicked. Jackson threatened to cut off Robards' ears.
Wow.
If he ever again suggested that he and Rachel had anything but an honorable, friendly relationship.
It's very random. There's a lot of things you could cut off, and he chose ears.
Yeah, well, maybe that was just to begin.
Oh, okay.
I'll
start with the ears and work my way down.
Don't give anyone any ideas. We don't need a suit.
No, not at all.
I got that idea from Jeff.
History Spaces.
On History Spaces.
I don't think I'm nearly that impressive, but
we are a litigious society. Did I say that right? Litigious? I think.
Litigious?
Litigious.
Yeah.
Is that it?
I think
okay,
so.
Okay, yeah. I mispronounced that on the radio a number of months ago, and you corrected me on that.
Jay Messerman at cedarbrooklibrary.org if you need to send us the proper.
Well, yeah, he's a member of the grammar police. Keeps me honest. Yeah. I'm
the reservist.
Now, one account of this whole disagreement had Jackson chasing Robards into a woods with a butcher knife during one of their arguments. So this was getting quite serious.
Bring me those ears, you rogue, you scoundrel.
Now, Robards, in retaliation for all this attention he was getting from Jackson in reaction to Robards' accusations, Robards had a warrant for disturbing the peace served on Jackson. And Robards, a constable, and several guards marched Jackson under guard to appear before a magistrate, a judge. Now, during the walk on the way there, however, Jeff, Jackson borrowed a hunting knife from one of the guards. Now, why would the guard give him a knife? I don't know.
What a good idea.
He probably knew all of these people. They were both, you know, he was a well-known person in the area.
Oh, it's okay. Give him a knife. He's just a man of quick emotions.
I just want to clean my nails or something. You know?
Yes.
What do you think? Well, Jackson took the knife and glancing threateningly at Robards from time to time, he carefully examined the sharp blade of the weapon. And then he'd look over at Robards, look back at the weapon, look over at Robards.
These people are like 8 years old.
Yeah, both very, you know, they're two children, it seems.
They very much are.
But anyway, Robards got the message and, losing his nerve, fled from Jackson into the woods and wasn't seen for quite a while. Now, all charges were dismissed since Robards was not present when the party finally arrived at the magistrate's court. So later that year, rumors spread that Robards had returned to Kentucky and had asked permission to proceed with the divorce. Now, this was interesting because in these days, if you wanted a divorce, you had to get an act from the state legislature granting you this divorce. It wasn't an easy thing to get.
Wow.
No fault divorce was not a thing. Okay.
Maybe it should still be that.
And I just read something and discussed this with my daughter. She's a wife that, you know, the advent of no fault divorce resulted in a lot of divorces, and people think, well, you know, it's just the end of marriage and all that, but actually, no-fault divorce allowed women a voice so that they could express their dissatisfaction with the way things were. And so really, no-fault divorce probably was a good thing because it allowed women not to be trapped in these marriages. And yeah,
the problem with that is that my wife and I have to have separate butters. Because I like to excavate the butter and she likes to scrape off the top, and she, the way I do it makes her crazy, and I'm always fearful that the butter factor may be the end of our marriage.
Well, you know, it's stupendous issues such as that really determine the day to day happiness of any couple. I think it's a lot of small.
We solved it though. We have, like I said, we have separate butters. It's his and hers.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, absolutely.
It does challenge our problem-solving ability, doesn't it?
Yes. So, yes, every day.
So flexibility is key there.
It is indeed.
Okay. Now, back to Rachel and Andrew. Now, assuming that Robards had, in fact, gotten the divorce, Andrew and Rachel got married. But the divorce was not granted until 2 years later in 1793.
I was just going to ask, was that a pretty quick turnaround? I guess not.
No. So it turned out that Rachel and Andrew were not legally married at all, and that Rachel was, technically speaking, a bigamist.
I was just going to say, I was kind of shacking up in sin a little bit there. Is that what's going on?
No,
but bigamy, they took it to the next
people
level.
People were much quicker to whip that sort of accusation out than they are now. But, well,
wow.
Now, finding out that their marriage was not a legal one, Jeff, Andrew and Rachel went through a second marriage ceremony to bring them into accordance with the law. So they thought, okay. Jackson thought that the issue was resolved then, and would be a forgotten footnote to the lives of him and his wife.
Until he decided to run for president.
Not true. You know, that was a temporary thing. And I don't mean to diminish, you know, the controversies and the problem that he was facing. But, you know, interesting, I found out, though, that Robards himself went back to Kentucky. And before he was granted a divorce, he got married again as well.
The high and mighty Robards.
Supposedly, he had a kind of a happy marriage and had 10 children.
There we go.
And his descendants to this very day live in Kentucky, in Bullitt County, Kentucky.
Bullitt County, Kentucky?
Yeah, no
one's
a
real place.
No one ever seemed to bring that up. You know, Rachel, yeah, okay, but he did the same thing, but no one ever hears about that.
That's amazing.
But of course, men always get a pass, don't we?
You know, I bet every Thanksgiving at the Robards table, they bring this up. They're just like, oh, those Jacksons.
Oh, gee, I know. Gee. How, you know, well, they thought the problem solved.
Right,
well,
right.
As his prominence as a politician grew, his political enemies used the issue of his, quote, stealing, unquote, of Robards' wife and their living together without being legally married to smear Jackson's reputation and moral character whenever possible. Always brought up. Now, the attacks on Rachel were particularly vicious because she was a woman, and according, you know, to the values and ideas of that day, she could not defend herself against attacks on her character. Women had absolutely no voice.
Wow.
You know, they had no place in public. They did not speak in public. And remember that there was that old phrase in the 19th century that a woman only had her name in the newspaper, if at all, in three occasions, when she was born, when she was married, and when she died. Other than that, you were completely in private. That's the standard.
Now, can we unpack this whole she does not speak in public? Are we saying that they...
Yeah, that's right.
Like...
Unless you're... You know, Elizabeth Cady Stanton or somebody, Elizabeth Woodhull or
sure. Someone
like that, you know, they broke, that's why they were so controversial, because they broke all the taboos.
Yeah.
And we think, oh, yeah, they were speaking in public, big deal. But just the fact that they were doing that offended many men, all men, it seemed, and
who does
many
she think,
women, too.
Right, right. Who does she think she is?
That's right, exactly.
Yeah, oh, my. Whew. Well, yeah, you know, we wonder where a lot of, in fact, I just this morning on the news show, they were talking about the Equal Rights Amendment working its way through Virginia today.
That's right.
And I was completely flabbergasted by this, because I thought this was a dead issue. I thought this is ERA is like a 70s thing. I thought we were done. Oh, yeah, we're not done.
Yeah, the deadline for having the states ratify it was sometime in the 1980s.
Yeah.
And they didn't make it to 38 states, but finally they did. But whether or not that's ever going to take effect, you know how controversial giving women equal rights is.
Lord.
I mean, boy, that could tear the country apart.
Oh my gosh! I mean,
really?
I was really surprised by that. So this is all kind of, and we wonder where all that comes from. Well, we're just currently today here on January 16th when we're recording 2020. We are still the product of all of this history. It's still laying there, and it's not going anywhere.
And I can do you one better here,
indeed.
And you can pass this along to the people who are recording the show. What's the one about race?
Bridge the Divide.
Bridge the Divide.
Yeah,
everyone. Come see the show being taped.
Mm-hmm.
Listen to it. It's wonderful. But here, I found out recently that the state of Mississippi did not, the legislature for the state of Mississippi did not ratify the 13th Amendment to the Constitution outlawing slavery until 1995.
Jeez. 90?
Can you believe that?
Unbelievable. So in 94... you could still maybe kind of get away with a slave or two.
They did not approve.
This is crazy. This is crazy.
Really? You couldn't even concede, okay, that's an amendment to the Constitution. We can't do it. 1995, well,
We think with our little glowing rectangle screens that we're so advanced, but I'll tell you what.
No, we're not.
We're just getting out of the caves, folks. We're just getting out of them.
I know. But I know Jeff and I laugh about a lot of stuff, but, you know, who said that? You know, I have to laugh. Lincoln said that. He said, I have to laugh because otherwise I'd cry.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
You know?
It's
so. Now, back to Andrew, though. He considered any attack on the character of Rachel an attack on himself.
Nobleman.
Yes. And if she could not defend herself against such insults, he would step in and defend her himself and to the death if necessary.
Seems like that type.
Yeah.
Wants to go defend to the death.
Quick to get angry.
Yes.
He's still a young man here when we're talking here. So, and when he was young, he was very fiery, supposedly. He mellowed a bit and with age. And maybe just to a slow burn, but you know, he was pretty fired. Now, on May 30th, 1806, Andrew Jackson fought a duel with a man named Charles Dickinson and found himself, for the sake of his wife Rachel, nearly a dead man.
Yeah.
Now, how did this happen? And I'm here to tell you the story, Jeff, because I can't leave you hanging.
Do you want a cliffhanger that over a break? Because actually, we're getting close to that.
I mean,
I
sure.
Get people to come back and hear... Hear that story, the story of Andrew and his near-death experience.
It was.
We'll be back.
See you later.
Macedonia Lullaby from Benny Goodman on that break there.
Yes, I think we're committing to sampling the Benny Goodman catalog that's available to us.
I actually, in my imagination, think the Benny Goodman Orchestra is right here in the studio with us. They're actually playing us to the break. So,
hello, Benny.
We're doing well. Thanks for coming in, guys. I have to pay the musicians union a little bit after the show.
Yeah,
but that's
we've
okay.
Expanded the studio. No,
can you imagine cramming that band in here? So, someone tried to put the Macedonia Lullaby on Andrew Jackson, I heard, before the...
Oh, my gosh. Well, let's see. This is one that duel that I'm going to speak of with Charles Dickinson is one of the most famous duels in American history. And well, let's just tell the story. In late 1805 and early 1806, as a result of gossip and a minor understanding having to do with a race, one of Jackson's horses had won. He was an avid horse racer. A few reckless words spoken about Rachel's character turned into a major incident that almost ended Jackson's political career as well as his life. Now, who is this Charles Dickinson? Now, Charles Dickinson was a young, reckless, arrogant attorney who was a partial owner of the horse that was defeated by Jackson's horse in a race and was reported... Dickinson was reported to be the best pistol shot in the state of Tennessee. Just thought I'd mention that going in. Yeah.
Now, how can we quantify that, Jerry?
Did they ever have a tournament?
I don't know. I'm just curious.
In a tavern while drinking with friends, Dickinson made some disparaging comments about Rachel. And when Jackson heard of them, he sought out Dickinson and confronted him face to face. And demanded an explanation. Now, Dickinson was very startled by this sudden confrontation, and he lamely explained that if he had made any rude comments about Mrs. Jackson, he had made them while drunk and did not mean what he said. Now, Jackson accepted this public explanation and left the tavern, but the matter did not end there. They rarely do they?
It should have.
Yeah.
I said something dumb while drunk. I apologize.
Well, here's where the politics come in, Jeff. Now, political enemies of Jackson were said to have encouraged Dickinson to continue making disparaging remarks about Jackson and his wife.
It's a good thing Dickinson didn't have Twitter.
Oh, gee.
Can you imagine?
Oh, gosh. Don't even go there. Twitter has been the worst possible thing that's happened to our political landscape.
Absolutely.
Well, not really the worst, but it hasn't helped.
It's up there.
Yeah. Now, troublemakers who were acquainted with the tension between the two men also spread inaccurate reports of comments made by both individuals. just making things up. Jackson then received another report of Dickinson making an insulting comment about the moral character of Rachel. And this, in addition to other misunderstandings, both real and imagined, right. caused Jackson to write a letter to Dickinson, challenging him to a duel so as to receive, quote, satisfaction, unquote, according to the code of honor lived by gentlemen of social standing.
I love that.
In the South.
I need to send more letters telling people that I need satisfaction. That's a great term, you know. I'll send one to the post office. I don't like your current postage rates, and I need satisfaction.
Watch it, Jeff. Treat me nice.
Right, yeah. I'm going to get a letter from
Jerry. I'm going to get satisfaction.
I have to get him a better slot on the broadcast.
You know, there's room for us to pace off with pistols out in the parking
lot.
That
is true. That is very true. It hasn't come to blow. You know, that happens in taverns. I noticed this all began in taverns, but seldom do you hear these stories beginning in libraries. So we're a nice bunch.
Well, I don't know. Well, I don't know. I've seen a few testy librarians in my day.
That's true. Overdue fees can get a little strange, but yes.
Oh, gee. Well, if we had something like that going on, I mean, a duel, you know, we could have a parade first.
We can make it a festival. Yeah. A duel festival.
And the pom-pom squad.
Sure.
And the floats. Church groups.
Meet you at Cedar Creek Park. It's all coming to a head.
The culmination of the entire weekend.
I say get rid of the ballot by the voting booths and let's do it that way.
Well, I think maybe that's the way they should do the election. I mean, it's the same thing. They're ripping each other. They're killing each other verbally.
True. That is true.
Now, the seconds, that's what they call the personal representatives of each of these parties, Jackson on one hand, Dickinson on the other, the seconds met to arrange the time and place and circumstances of their meeting. Okay, let's call a meeting. Now, Jackson and Dickinson were to meet on the morning of January 31st, 1806.
It's an anniversary coming up for us then.
That's right.
We're on the verge here. About 3 weeks, two and a half weeks away.
Yes. Interesting. Yeah.
Who knew? You planned this out so well, Jerry. I love that.
Hadn't thought about that, but you know, that was a coinky dink here. Now, and at a distance of 24 feet, were to each be armed with a single-shot pistol and could fire at will upon a signal given by an agreed-upon individual.
I'm a cheater. I'd have brought a bazooka. Just level the whole area.
Conceal carry.
Right.
Actually, I've met people who are afraid to go into public places because they don't know who's armed anymore.
Oh, sure.
I mean,
yeah.
Even into a Walmart or someplace.
Yeah, that's where we're at, unfortunately, at this time, day and age. Yeah.
Yeah, anyway. In the days leading up to the duel, Dickinson publicly displayed his skill with the pistol by firing 5 shots into a target that was the size of a silver dollar at a distance of, guess what, 24 feet.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Sending a message, not so veiled,
yes,
to his opponent.
He also amazed observers by hanging a piece of string from a limb of a tree and splitting it in two with a single shot from a pistol. He was practicing.
This sounds like lore more than real. I mean, to split a string with a bullet, that's pretty impressive.
Well, much of history is like that.
That
we've explored that sort of thing. Remember last week, all the different stories for where this or that historical fact actually comes from? We don't know. Now, Dickinson was then supposed to have said, after he split that string with a single shot, he said, quote, "If General Jackson comes along this road, show him that," unquote. Now, get this. Bets were being placed by people in Nashville and around the state. And most of the money was being wagered on Dickinson to win the duel.
Ah, very good. All
yeah,
right.
So
well, he's the string splitter of the two.
Yeah, well, he was. Maybe he had the biggest. I think he had the biggest mouth.
I was going to say probably the best PR.
Yeah. So, you know, people just bet on him. But Jackson was keeping it close to the vest and himself. Now, Dickinson himself had wagered $300 on himself. that he would kill Jackson.
It'd be funnier if he actually wagered it on Jackson.
So, yeah. Well, there go the odds.
Absolutely.
And now bank gambling was unregulated at the time. And dueling was supposedly illegal, too, but he did it anyway.
Sure. Oh, now, it was supposed, actually was illegal at that time?
Yes, it was. Illegal.
Good.
In 1803, was it, when Burr killed Hamilton? Yeah, that was illegal, too, but they did it anyway. So, now, while practicing, Dickinson had outlined Jackson's form on a tree and had boasted of how many times he had hit it.
Oh, he's good.
Yeah.
He's good.
Real good PR on
absolutely.
This.
Absolutely.
No wonder people thought Jackson was a dead man, really.
It's like now, WWF, basically. It's like Hulk Hogan versus Andre the Giant.
A real SmackDown.
Totally. SmackDown among gentlemen.
Oh,
amongst gentlemen.
Now, Jackson was aware of the superior skill of his opponent. And with the help of his friend, John Overton, if you read anything about Jackson, you know, he was instrumental in his rise and the outcome of his political career. But anyway, Jackson and Overton worked out a strategy for engaging his adversary. Now, Jackson, let me see, when Dickinson was out there talking and promoting, Jackson was plotting. So you can see where this is going.
There are two kinds of people in this world, Jerry. PR people and plotters.
Yeah. So Jackson wore an oversized blue frock coat and trousers that hid his thin and angular frame beneath a billowing layer of material. That was the strategy here. Also, he and Overton decided to let Dickinson fire first so that if Jackson were trying to fire it the first time, the impact from a bullet would not spoil his aim. And then, even if injured, hopefully not killed.
Right,
you know,
right.
He was taking a chance here. Then even if injured, he could steady himself and return fire.
Right, this isn't Kevlar he's wearing. This is cloth.
This is just cloth.
Multiple layers, but nonetheless, you know.
Yep. Now, he meant to do this, he said, that's Jackson, that is, even if it were the last act of his life, that is, even if he were hit, he would stand up and he would kill his opponent. The men met just across the border of Tennessee in Kentucky so they could cross over the line. And since the duel took place in Kentucky,
yes.
They would soon escape and then they couldn't be arrested.
Absolutely.
So
for dueling.
Yes. The men met across the border of Tennessee in Kentucky amidst a clearing in a forest of poplar trees. Now, stakes had been placed in the ground 24 feet or 8 paces
yes.
apart, and the men took their places at the stakes with pistols in their right hands.
It's a good thing they used the stakes, because if it were me, I would have been haggling about the space, how many inches it was. I'd be haggling for days. I mean, oh, that's not.
Now, this was the job of the representatives, their seconds. Oh, they would come out there, and they'd both, you know, they'd measure it out and everything and load the pistols, and
sure.
each side got to approve of all circumstances. Now, here also, there was no meeting back to back with pistols at the red, you know, and then taking your paces. No, you just stood at the stakes
and shoot each other.
Yeah. So
turkey shoot, basically.
Now, Jackson stood slightly angled, not placing his body directly facing Dickinson, thus exposing even less of a target for Dickinson to shoot at.
Shrewd, very shrewd.
Yeah. So, because he was kind of a skinny guy.
Yeah.
Very wiry, strong, but not a big man.
Joe Pesci could play him.
No, not tall enough. No. He was about
he was
6 feet to 6'2", something. Oh. He was a good size,
gotcha.
You know, tall.
Okay.
Now, John Overton, Jackson's friend, had won the right to supervise the duel and give the signal to fire. Now, Overton asked both of them, "Are you ready?" And when both Jackson and Dickinson answered, "I am ready," Overton said the word fire. Now, at this cue, Dickinson quickly raised his pistol, aimed, and fired. The bullet streaked across the 8 paces, separating the men, grazed Jackson's shoulder, which was out toward Dickinson. Remember, he was standing sideways.
Sure, sure.
and then continued on, struck his chest, shattering two ribs, lodging in his chest an inch from his heart.
Wow.
The bullet. Jackson's left arm shot up to the hole in his chest, covering a wound that was bleeding profusely. But all of this was hidden by his baggy coat. No one could see.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. Jackson wavered momentarily, grimacing in pain, his chest throbbing, and then stood erect and still, desperately trying to regain his composure. Jackson slowly and with great deliberation raised his pistol and aimed it at Dickinson. Dickinson was struck with terror to see that Jackson was still standing, and he cried out and said, quote, "My God, have I missed him?" unquote. Dickinson then stepped a few paces backward away from Jackson. This moving from the assigned station was a violation of the rules that dictated behavior during duels between gentlemen.
This duel is off.
Now, Overton, the Jackson second, who was supervising, raising his pistol and aiming it at the terrorized man, that is Dickinson, said, quote, "Back to the mark, sir," unquote. If Dickinson had refused to step back to his assigned mark or had turned to run from the field, Overton would have been obliged to shoot him.
That's part of the dueling
That's
rules, too?
That's part of the code.
Very
That's
nice.
Right.
Okay.
But Dickinson did calm himself enough to return to his assigned place, and with his body squarely facing Jackson across the empty space between them, folded his arms across his chest to protect his vital organs, and bowed his head and awaited his opponent's return fire.
Which organs do you pick at that point? I can cover my kidneys and my spleen, but I'm really exposing my pancreas and my that's a split second decision.
We don't have enough arms to cover everything worth covering
all,
here.
They're all critical.
I know.
I'm big on, you know, my liver. I want my liver to
I suppose the way to protect against that is don't get in that sort of situation in the first place.
But that's not that we're not going to talk about that right now.
I'll remember that the next time I feel the need for satisfaction.
Absolutely. Yeah, I was thinking as you're going here that like how big golf is at country clubs. I think they should take up dueling. I think that would be great. 24-foot dueling, you know, with, you know, I think that would be a very honorable thing. And I think the extremely wealthy could show just how powerful they are by dueling regularly, put it on television.
Well, maybe we could have a duel with paintball. Paintball, you know, and kind
no,
of
that's
do a
no fun.
Duel.
No, that's not going to work for me.
Not violence enough, huh?
And then, you know, there's a golf channel. We could have a dueling channel on the set, your satellite dish, you know, channel 583.
I hadn't thought of that.
This is huge.
Well, cable is still expanding. I mean, there are all sorts of things. Maybe on the dark web we could find.
But I need the works. I need top hats. I mean, every sport has a uniform, so I want top hats, overcoats, you know, fine shoes, well polished.
No, yeah.
I want the works here.
Well, I don't. You know, I suppose we don't mean to diminish the importance of the Jackson Dickinson duel here, and maybe I should just get back here because we left it.
Yes,
Dickinson, with his head bowed and just standing there waiting for Jackson to fire. Now, Dickinson was now at the mercy of Jackson and could do nothing to escape whatever fate sent screaming towards him out of the barrel of Jackson's pistol. Do you like that dramatic
That's pretty
phrase?
Good. Yeah, that was awesome. Yeah,
like?
That was,
should I say that again?
That was like Lowell Thomas. Yeah. You know?
I thought I was being a little overly dramatic there.
No, never. You can't
underline that.
It's radio. No, you're good. You're right in.
Yeah. His fate was screaming towards him out of the barrel of Jackson's pistol.
Walter Winchell here for him. Your moment in history.
Yeah. Now, it was within Jackson's power to refuse to shoot at his opponent, sure, if he so chose, or fire a shot in the air, thus ending the duel.
Oh, you're only allowed one shot?
Yep.
Oh.
But Jackson had made a promise to his friends and himself that he would hit or wound Dickinson in order to teach the young man a lesson. He was, Jackson thought, a loudmouth, reckless man who was a public nuisance and it disgraced the honor of both himself and his defenseless wife. So he's not letting anyone off here.
Absolutely.
With those thoughts racing through his mind, pain racking his chest, and remaining standing through sheer willpower, he pulled the trigger. Now, but the hammer stopped at half cock, not detonating the powder in the barrel of his pistol. And for a moment, just everyone was frozen in place. And then Jackson recocked his pistol because he gets to discharge his pistol one time. And again, he pulled the trigger. This time, the pistol flashed as the bullet exploded from the muzzle of his gun and with a lethal velocity shrieked toward Dickinson's downcast, waiting figure.
Yes.
Now, the bullet slammed into Dickinson's abdomen just below his ribs, sliced a jagged trail through his intestines, and exited his body on the other side. Dickinson spun around and fell to the ground, and his doctor, running over to him and tearing open his clothing, trying to stem the flow of blood from the wound. The doctor instantly recognized the wound as a fatal one, because they each would bring their own personal physician.
Oh, of course, case, yeah.
Now,
a cut man in your corner, basically. Yes. Yeah.
Now, Dickinson was slowly bleeding to death. Jackson immediately began walking from the field, determined to reveal nothing to his opponents about his injuries or his pain. About 100 yards from the site of the duel, his surgeon, who was walking with him, noticed that his shoes were full of blood. Blood had been running down his body. And, "My God, General Jackson, are you hit?" he asked Jackson. Jackson responded with the words, "Oh, I believe that he has pinked me a little. Let's look at it." Now, there was nothing the doctor could do but bandage the wounds the best he could. Remember, that bullet was lodged inch from his heart.
Absolutely.
And he returned Jackson to his home as quickly as possible. Jackson was confined to his bed for nearly a month, and even more months passed before he could move around without considerable pain and discomfort. Now, when asked afterwards how he had managed to return fire when he himself was so badly wounded, Jackson revealed the power of his determination by saying, quote, "I'd have hit him if he shot me through the brain," unquote. Still a lot of hatred going on there. Now, the injury never healed properly. And for years afterwards, Jackson felt the agonizing effects of this perilous gunfight with Charles Dickinson. He carried the bullet next to his heart for the rest of his life, sometimes thinking of it as a symbol of the extent he would go to passionately defend the honor and reputation of his beloved Rachel.
Well, I guess that's a happy ending.
Well, we're only halfway through the story, however.
That is true.
Yeah, that's just one event to illustrate this. Now, next week we'll do Andrew and Rachel Part 2 and on to the presidency, okay? And
that sounds good.
And things got even worse. That's my gosh.
This is like a Saturday afternoon serial.
Anyway.
Two-fisted Andrew Jackson.
Thanks, everyone, for coming in. And, Jeff, always nice to be here.
That was fun.
Okay.
I like a good romance.
Fun.
I like a good duel. This was all perfect.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. Until next week.
See you later. Bye.
History Spaces is produced in conjunction with CPL Radio, a service of the Cedarburg Public Library.